U-Neek, DJ U-Neek, DJ U-Neek, DJ U-Neek, DJ U-Neek.
The government needs to be exposed because it cannot be trusted to expose itself.
We live in exciting and fearful times.
Here with DJ U-Neek of Bone Feathers and Harmony. You know what I'm saying? I'm out here looking at the beautiful view. You know, what I've been doing, I've been interviewing a lot of cats, you know what I'm saying, speaking on their most memorable moments, people that was down from the beginning, you know. And also, this is March 2013. This is the 18th year anniversary to my man Eazy-E's death. So this is a hell of a time, you know what I'm saying? As y'all know, March 26th is when he died, you know, in 1995. So also, this is the month for Bone's 20th anniversary. And so I've been doing a couple little segments on my new website, BoneThugsDJUneek.com, and interviewing the producers and different people that was around, even my kids that was around, because they've been born into the whole Bone movement, you know what I'm saying? So I've been just interviewing and getting people's most memorable moments. So now it's my turn to speak on one of many most memorable moments with Bone Thugs and Harmony. And this one right here was crazy. This is back when we first signed with Eazy-E. One of the situations that we went through, so I want y'all to check it out, you know what I'm saying? And also, keep on hitting up BoneThugsDJUneek.com and to keep up with the latest, what's going on with Bone, myself. As you see, I got the Hollywood Squares, you know what I'm saying? I got my new compilation, Block to Block, Hood to Hood. I got a lot of things jumping off, so I need y'all to definitely stay posted, you know what I'm saying? So check out this most memorable moment as I take y'all through the journey of what happened with me and Bone. Check it out. Yeah, so right here, it's like the back entrance to Ruthless. So this is the back street that Eazy used to come down, and he'd creep in through the back. They had a back parking right here. And this is the way he would always come in to the office. It's right here where this parking structure is at right here. And he'll come in, and he didn't film a couple of his commercials on top of this parking structure. You know what I'm saying? Like when he dropped his EP, we filmed the commercial to it on top of this this parking structure, you know what I'm saying? So what is it, February 3rd, Sunday? And Sunday would be the day when he would choose to film stuff when it's quiet and stuff like that. But this was the way in right here. So this is where the original office of Rufus Records, this is where Eazy, the whole NWA movement, Shelle, DOC, Above the Law, it all started right here. Eazy had his own parking, you know, slot right here. He would park right here sometime. Or if he didn't want to be noticed, whatever, he'll park all the way up to the top, and we would park right here. Come out of here, then we'd go around to the office, which is 21860 right here. And this is where Bone got signed at. This is where it all went down, right here, Woodland Hills. You know what I'm saying? Let me show you the. Look at this one. Some type of. So it's some type of great American group now. But this was it right here. Right here. Right here, right here. You know what I'm saying? We in 2013, which is like the anniversary year for Bone Thugs coming in doing the Faces of Death up on the Bone Enterprise. But this will be their 20th anniversary this year for Bone Thugs and Harmony. So the month is February. And I just want to show you guys where all the magic happened right here. Right up in here, make that right turn. That was Rufus Records, you know what I'm saying? Rest in peace to my nigga Eazy. Now I'm going to show you this incident that happened right down the street at Wells Fargo. That was crazy, you know what I'm saying? That happened to me and Bone. So we're going to go over there right now. Let's go check it out. Yo, so this Wells Fargo right here. Oh my goodness. So we get a check one day from Eazy. He get a fellow the gang of money, and we go to this Wells Fargo right here on Oxnard and Topanga, right down the street from Rufus Records, right? So we go into the bank, you know, and this is during like the first year when Bone was out here, like 94. And you know, they wasn't really, they'd take the braids down, wouldn't comb their hair, wear stocking caps, wear scullies. So they go into the bank dressed like that. And they going in there with like an $80,000 check.
No, this check was for about, I think, 40. You know what I'm saying? It was about 40,000. And they go in there and cash the check right here at this Wells Fargo. So what we was told was that a person that was, you know, coming out of the bank saw us coming in and thought that we was going in to rob the bank. You know what I'm saying? So what happened is, so we, you know what I'm saying, we go in there, we cash the check, do all that, and then the next thing you know, we come out the bank, you know what I'm saying, we come out the bank and we coming to this street right here. So right when we come right here, we see about 6 police cars flying by. Soon we stop, right? I got Bone, we all in the car. And we looking, you know, sirens going, and they going to the right of us, right, flying by. We look like, damn, wonder what happened. You know, so that's what we said, well, damn. So we go ahead, come on out, you know what I'm saying, and go to Topanga. And we rolling on out, you know what I'm saying, going to the studio, you know. So Topanga's a busy street out here in the valley, you know what I'm saying. And by the way, Rufus Records right down the street. The label still is kicking, and it's right here. But anyway, we turned down Topanga, and Topanga looking kind of clear. I'm kind of like, you know, by me being from here, I'm knowing how busy the street is. So I'm like, man, you know what I'm saying, it's kind of strange how Topanga, you know what I'm saying, don't really have no cars on it, you know. So we go ahead and turn on Topanga, just like I'm doing right now. I got 4 members with me, though. I got 4 of them. Busy wasn't with us, so I'm going just like I'm going right now, rolling. But it's on a weekday, and it's like no cars on both sides, no cars. So I'm going to the 101 freeway, you know what I'm saying, which I'm approaching right now. So I get on. So me and Bone, you know what I'm saying, we rolling. And once I hit this loop right here, and jump on the 101 going south, and I see the freeway is clear. We the only car on the 101 south freeway at 3 o'clock in the daytime, which is traffic time. And I knew something was up. I said, man, something ain't right. So, you know, we continue to roll, and we get down here right before you get to the Tampa exit. And I'm looking like, is that somebody standing in the middle of the freeway? And I see, like, you know, some little people standing in the freeway as I'm rolling. And I notice that they're holding shotguns. They're holding shotguns, aiming dead at us. So I hit the brakes. Bones start freaking out, ducking behind the seat. We don't know what's going on. They like, Tim, what's going on, Tim? They going to kill us or whatever, you know what I'm saying? So I'm looking. I can't hear. I'm yelling, shut up. I left the window down so I can hear them. And they talking to us through the little horn, you know, telling the driver to get out. So there's how many lanes on this freeway? 1. I'm gonna show you what lane they had me lay in. They had me lay in the far fast lane that I'm in right now. I laid in this lane, lazy laid in this lane right here. Flesh was in this lane, Crazy Bone was in this lane, and they had Wishbone. They had us in all 4 of those lanes, you know what I'm saying? With the shotguns drawn, they had about like 5 shotguns drawn, had the FBI badges around the neck like a necklace. And man, everybody on the other side of the freeway was, you know what I'm saying, clapping and hooraying like they caught some bank robbers, taking pictures of us and everything, man, like we just robbed a bank. And they took us to the police station over here off of Van Orn. And what area is that over there? The police station, yeah, the Van Nuys police station, yeah. And they held us, and man, we wanted to sue them, man. Keisha Malone, she was at Roots at the time, she was upset, but you know, we didn't, you know, press charges or nothing. But that was one of the craziest situations that I've been through with Bone. That was one of them, you know what I'm saying. And it was crazy to be laying out on the 101 freeway, each one of us in each lane face down, you know what I'm saying. And we just cashed like a $45,000 check or something like that. And that's one of my stories right there, you know what I'm saying, from Bone Thugs. So that was 1994, like summer 1994, man. And then Easy hit him off again for Christmas to go home, you know what I'm saying, with a crazy amount, you know what I'm saying. But that was a crazy incident, you know. And a lot of people didn't know that first of the month almost didn't make Eternal, you know what I'm saying. The fellas were so ready to go home, they had been working so hard, they was ready to get back to Cleveland. And man, I had to pull Crazy Bone to the side and really, man, damn near beg, you know what I'm saying, for him to come on into the room and listen to this last track, you know what I'm saying, because they was burnt out. And I thank God that he came on, you know, he came in and listened. And man, first of the month, you know what I'm saying, happened, you know what I'm saying, because it was the last song that we recorded for the Eternal album.
Tuned into Bone Thugs, DJUneek.com. I'm DJ Uneek of Bone Thugs and Harmony. And yo, this is where it goes down, baby. Thug love. Yeah.
Yo, yo, yo. I'm here at the Black Hole Studio with my man Kenny McLeod. You know what I'm saying? This is one of the co-producers with me on the first EP, Creeping on the Come Up. Thuggish, Ruggish, Bone. Creeping on the Come Up. No Surrender. You know what I'm saying? This is the man right here, you know what I'm saying, that engineered. And this was the studio that we first did everything at, you know. And I can recall my man Easy hitting me up like one morning, like 7 o'clock in the morning, telling me to get my man Kenny up because he had these cats coming in from Cleveland fresh off the bus. And he was excited about him, so I had to wake my man up early. And he came through, you know what I'm saying, trying to see what was the urgency about. And man, we didn't know it was going to be a life-changing situation like that, man. So, Ken, I'm going to let you go ahead and fill him in on your memories and the beginnings of, you know, working with Bone.
Oh, yeah. What's up, Uneek? How you doing today?
Chilling.
First of all, and, like you said, when you called me up back in the day, Uneek, it was early in one morning, and I'm like, damn, what's the urgency just wanting to get up? And who are these guys from Cleveland?
Yeah.
You know, Easy guy coming in. This Easy first time coming into the studio, you know, Uneek brought him through, and they came on down to the studio, and Uneek had Easy with these five other guys, and they called us at Bone, and they had some ideas for some music, and, you know, we started laying it down, and trying to make it happen, you know?
Yeah.
Me and Uneek, we started putting the beats together for him and producing everything and engineering it and producing, mixing it and putting it all together and making it happen for the fellas.
Man.
And pretty much, they did their thing from there.
Yeah.
It was on the radio. Like,
instantly, in 2 weeks.
It was on the radio.
Yeah.
You know, they had it going on the radio. Easy, he was doing his thing.
Yeah.
And
you remember Easy would come by your spot, man, sometime at night and jump on the keyboards and try to make beats and everything, man. He just would
Yeah, he would come down there and he was like, I could do this by myself sometimes. You know, I could play his keyboard. His favorite little instrument, I think, back then, he always wanted to play the sitar.
Yeah.
Like, the sitar sound, Ken.
Yeah.
You know, Easy.
Yeah.
He brought it up and we fumbled around, but we never did nothing with it.
Yeah, man, because I got them tracks somewhere too, man, where Easy playing around trying to do his own beats and everything.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, man, on a 16-track 1-inch. Take it back in the day, man. But it was like the Black Hole became the spot where he would kind of end his day. He would wind up coming over there and just kick it the whole night. He done came from Audio Achievements and checked on all the other studios, and then he'll come kick it with us, you know. But, hey, man, but what was it like when you first heard the fellas? You remember when they first came into your studio, dog?
Oh, yeah, man, we thought they was Indians. Or they had a new style. They were coming to the studio like, we said, oh man, we got to work again with these Indians today. But them Indians, 2 weeks later, they tried to be like, dang, this is a new style.
Hell yeah.
They had it going on.
Sure did, man. I'm telling you, man.
Yeah, it was just a pleasure being a part of something that big, and, you know, and Busy Bone, you know, he helped contribute a lot to me when I was, you know, putting it together, you know.
Yeah.
He was one of the main guys that hooked it up with me.
Yeah.
So, and then the rest of the guys, you know, Flesh.
Yeah.
He was the one that ended up spray painting my studio one day. He took a spray paint.
Uh-oh.
And he started spray painting around the studio, you know.
Now, this is one of Kenny's memorable moments with Bone. Now, this shit right here is crazy. Go ahead, brother.
Yeah. So, out there, we confronted Flesh. Like, man, you know, why are you doing that down here at the studio? We know what you did at the other studio over there. This is a black-owned studio. You know, chill out. We said, next thing we know, Eazy-E had a belt around his neck, like a collar, carrying Flesh around the studio like that. I was like, yeah. So every time I seen Easy, Flesh was right there somewhere nearby. Easy was controlling that boy.
Yeah, man, that they had to control him, man. That was some crazy times right there, man.
Yeah,
you know, man.
Everybody turned out being real respectful, and you know,
yeah,
had a great time and. We made some nice records, you know?
Yeah, man. You know what? I recall, man, when we was standing in front of your studio
Easy was having a conversation with him, and Flesh was the one I really remember because he had a red sweatshirt, you know, because Cleveland Indians and stuff like that, you know, like where they from, they wasn't really on that color kick too much. But Easy was like telling me, man, you're going to have to take off that red sweatshirt. So when I pulled up, you know, Easy was like, man, won't you tell this nigga, man, he can't be wearing it. And Flesh finally gave in because Flesh wasn't taking off that shit for nothing. And he threw it in the trunk of Easy's Benz. But we was like, yeah, man, the color thing is serious out here, bro.
Yeah,
that was. I remember that, man. That was crazy, man.
Going down to Piggies for a hamburger.
Going down to Piggies, man. That's right, man. And the Black Hole Studio back then was in Hawthorne. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? A lot of people came through there, dog. Can you, man? Like, tell us some of the names that came through there, man. Because it was a lot of folks. Domino. It go on and on, man.
Battlecat used to.
Yeah.
Produce a lot of artists down there, including Domino. All the way from Curtis Blow.
Yeah.
Up into I was messing with, you know, Herb Albert.
Damn.
From A&M Records back in the day, working with him.
Yeah.
All the way up to, you know, Bone, Porn and Sisters.
Everybody, dog. I mean, look, man, I'm gonna tell you
Digital Underground,
but I'm gonna tell you what I really remember. DJ Quick coming through there, right?
Oh, yeah.
When he first made that 90-minute mixtape, yeah, him and High C.
Yeah.
And it was like this mixtape he made, which wound up being Quick is the name, but he came down there with like a little Tascam 688. He used to go to your back studio in the back.
Yeah.
And yeah, man, and he was putting that album together, dog, and didn't know that sucker was gonna be a classic. It was like that was mixtape back then, dog. That was like 1990, early 90, you feel me? And that nigga Quick is talented.
Respected his talent, and you know.
Yeah.
Look up to Quick and what he doing.
Yeah, that's right, man.
Cool brother, you know.
But man, let's fast forward to right now. We just finished up the Art of War, World War III with Bone Thugs and Harmony, man. I wanted you to kind of kick what you think about the project, man. You know, me and you done got back together, man. It's funny, you know what I'm saying? Full circle, because we was the original producers for the fellas.
Right.
And man, tell me what you think about the Art of War, World War III, man.
Oh, I think it's bringing out a whole new side to them. But bringing back the essence that they still want from back in the day, you know, giving them that Bone sound, along with the new sound that's happening today.
Yeah.
It's sort of a mixture, but you still got the elements of that, you know, DJ U-Neek, Kenny McLeod, Black Hole thing going right there, along with all of it. So I think this is the best way to bring Bone back in a raw kind of way.
Yeah.
Like they came out before.
Yeah, man. You know what I'm saying? But you and Busy put down some great stuff, man. Y'all produced a few of them together, man. And like Born in the Ghetto is a bona fide hit, man. I believe it's going to be a great big single for the Art of War 3, man. You know?
That's right.
Yeah, man. So I just wanted you to kind of like speak on it, man. And we just finished the project, and it's due to come out late April, May 2013. So it's me and Kenny McLeod, and you know what I'm saying? And we putting it down, man. You know what I'm saying? So this is the Black Hole, baby, where it all started. You know what I'm saying? This is it here. Right here, baby. Yeah. It's all real. If you can't face reality, probably feel this hate is trying to kill my character. It's harder to try to survive. Yeah. That's a joint taken from Art of War, World War III. It's called Deep End, featuring Portia, right here on the boards, right here. She did a lot of features on this new album, a lot of background singing. She really came through for us. So
for sure.
I just wanted to interview you because you got a big part on this project, you know?
Thank you.
So let me know, you know, what you think about the project.
I love the project, actually. I think it's a very put together and very unique idea.
Yeah.
I couldn't say that there's anything out there better right now, and as far as I'm concerned, we need the Bone Thugs to come back for sure.
That's real.
You know, we got U-Neek up here putting it together, up here at the Black Hole Studio, and utilizing me to come in and feature and write and sing. And I love to record and with U-Neek and Kenny McLeod, which is my husband.
Yeah.
And we will be back.
That's right.
Coming at you real hard and real tough, so don't worry about it.
Yes, yes. She got a lot of things going on, you know, solo-wise. She raps, sing, do it all. And the song Deep End, she wrote the chorus to, you know, songwriter. What was some of the, you know, some of your favorite cuts from the album?
Oh, that's very easy. Ghetto, Top Notch, Bone, Money, Deep End, of course.
Yeah, that's right.
And pretty much Swagged Out, you know?
Swagged Out,
yeah,
huh?
Yeah, I love that. That's what I'm talking about definitely. Right there. We need to have some brothers out here swagged out.
That's real, that's real. So, you know, as far as the fellas coming here recording the project, you know what I'm saying, what was your experience with that? You know, actually being in the studio with them recording, you know?
Oh, well, that was the very deep and historical and legendary feeling that I had and I got introduced to, and I'm very happy and glad that I got to experience it. And the beauty that they have when they're together, you know, as far as coming together with all this new viewpoints and also coming together and being melodic, especially, that was my favorite part about it. Taught me some things.
Yeah.
You know, and they are and will always be approved of in the music industry. So we don't have to worry about them. They are the greatest as far as I'm concerned.
That's real. So Art of War, World War III, in your book is definitely a great one, huh? A great project.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. And I appreciate you.
That's that's a chapter in this book we can't stop reading.
That's real, huh?
They got it going. That's what I'm talking about.
That's right. So this is Portia here live at the Black Hole Studio. She's featured, like I said, on the Art of War, World War III. So I'm just giving you guys, you know, the people that make it happen behind the scenes. You know what I'm saying? So thanks, Portia, for your contributions.
And
I can't wait till the album drop.
I can't wait either.
Peace. Yo, I'm here at LA Studios with my man V-Mix, aka Virgil Davis. You see that right on the plaque, Art of War. That's the man behind the sound on an Art of War. As you see, the Days of Our Lives plaque from Set It Off soundtrack, you know what I'm saying? This is the man right here, you know what I'm saying? Play all the instruments, engineer, produce, songwrite, website, whatever it is you need it, you know what I'm saying? But this is the man, you know? We got the V drums over here. You see what I'm saying? They go the tools right there. They go the tools. So my man, I met him back in the day, and it's ironic that he happened to be from the same hood, Compton, where my nigga Easy is from, you know? Man, give me a little insight, man, back, you know, in the days, man, because you knew Eric back, you know what I'm saying, before the Ruthless days, shit.
Yeah, I kind of knew Eric when he had his little El Camino. He's getting his little street hustle on. We'd be over in Kelly Park on our knees right by the bathroom shooting craps.
Yeah.
He was known for once he hit a lick, get that money and take off. You might as well get your chance to win your money back.
Hell no. Yeah. Nigga, that's the shit right there. So that nigga should be gambling like a motherfucker.
Yeah, he'd be out there, you know, like trying to get a little extra change going, you know.
Yeah.
Good in the hood.
Shit, man. I mean, nigga, that's some shit right there. You know what I'm saying? Cats do not know. You feel me? So, yeah, my man is from the same neighborhood, you know? So, as far as the Bone, man, you've been part of the run, man, from the Art of War all the way up, man. You know what I'm saying? So, this has been, you know, based on the most memorable moments with Bone, you feel me? So, tell me, man, one of your episodes, bro. Bone episodes.
Bone episode. Billboard Awards. What, 2006? I mean, 96?
Yeah, I think 96. In Las Vegas, yeah.
Las Vegas. Well, I think they won R&B Artist of the Year.
Yeah, it was the R&B category, yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, uh-huh.
And, you know, had the big show performance getting ready to take place, and we had the pyrotechnics. I was going to do a tribute to Easy and Biggie. You know, it's Crossroads, and he's gonna do Days of Our Lives because that was a big song for him off the Set It Off soundtrack.
Yeah.
So.
And you was playing what instrument on there?
I was playing a piano.
Okay, piano for the band. So you was set to perform as part of the Billboard show.
Yeah, you know how Crossroads had that big piano intro.
Yeah.
You know, so I was on the big old 9-foot ball and piano with the hood up, baby.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We're supposed to have the tux with the tail and all that thing like that, but it didn't quite take place because during the rehearsal for the show, the pyrotechnics kind of set things on fire.
Damn.
And we had to rush off the stage, and things was falling out the air on the drums. It was a mess.
Hell no.
So we didn't get to do the show. Mm. Because it wasn't enough time for them to, you know, get our soundboard back together and things like that. So, fellas was quite disappointed. Mm. I think Billboard wanted them to perform off of that, whatever. But they didn't feel that because we had a nice little show put together. And it was like, my man Lay said, if it was ZZ Top, y'all would have took care of him. You know what I'm saying?
Hell yeah.
So he was a little disappointed. So they went on and took off. And, you know, we had a good time anyway.
Mm.
That was about my most memorable moment, you know.
That shit was crazy because I remember coming afterwards. See, I didn't see what took place, but I saw the ambulance, I saw the fire truck. I said, damn, what the hell done happened? And I didn't know it was for us. You know what I'm saying? It was like our whole set was on fire, man. That shit was crazy as hell, man.
Yeah, I was trying to figure out what was going on. And I was like, Neek, what's going on? Are we going to do the show? And you looked at me, you're like, tap Cassie. You said, telling Cassie.
Tell him the bad news. Hell yeah.
I'm talking about Cassandra Ware.
Yeah.
She was at Rufus at the time.
Hell yeah. Cassandra Ware, man. Yeah, that was my girl.
That was my girl right there, Cassandra. And she said, V, it ain't going to happen, baby.
Hell yeah, man. But yeah, this is my man V-Mix. I'm talking about all that music and stuff that you guys have been hearing behind Bone, man. This cat has been laying it down, and he's part of the new album, Art of War, World War III, you know what I'm saying? So I just wanted you to give him a little insight on that. How you feel about that, man?
Oh, yeah. Good stuff. Classic Bone stuff we're trying to put together.
Yeah.
You know, I believe we got a little something for you like to check out, you know, little snippets or whatever.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's what the fans been asking for, you know, the classic Bone stuff. You know, some groups, you know, have to, you know, conform to, you know, how music changes and whatnot. I think Bone is not one of those groups.
Yeah.
I think they set a standard and a tone that everybody kind of, you know, took a piece of.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and to me, that's just a compliment of you know, you did something special, something good, you know, everybody from Timberland, you know, up till now. You know,
yeah.
You know, took a piece of, you know, that Bone tempo, that Bone style.
Yeah, that's, you know, real.
It changed R&B music.
It did, man.
It changed R&B music. So, you know, that's one of my favorite Bone moments. It wasn't my favorite, but it's like, you know, more memorable one because, like, you know, with, you know, Billboard Awards.
Yeah. But you know what, man? I was going to say that, you know what, you said key thing though, like the Art of War does, Art of War, World War III does go back and capture like the old stuff, you know what I'm saying? And they're going to be really satisfied for those Bone fans that's been asking for that, you know what I'm saying? We really capture that, you know? So I'm here with my man V-Mix, you know what I'm saying? At LA Studios, you know what I'm saying? And we signing out. Peace. Yo, yo, I'm here with DJ U-Neek Middleton. And just want to ask him a few things, like, what were some of his memories, you know what I'm saying, of, you know, being around Bone, you know what I'm saying? He's been around, he came in like 98, so just want to see what he remembers, some of his fondest memories of hanging out with the Bone fellas or just anything. So let me know, man.
I remember basically like working in the studio. My dad was working in the studio with them, and they always be like playing PlayStation, or they'll be writing, and then they'll be working on the album, Bone for Life, I think it was called.
So what do you think about the new Bone album, though, the new Art of War, World War III project?
I'm pretty excited.
Yeah, so, man, it's pretty soon. You're going to be doing some tracks for him, man, because you really get busy on the tracks, learning all the different programs, man. You know, you're working Reasons and Pro Tools 10 and all that stuff, man. So are you looking forward to working with a Bone mate, like, in the future or whatever? Because crazy, them already listening to your tracks and stuff, you know, and busy. They already listen to your tracks. So you are ready for that?
Yeah, I'm pretty excited. If I'm able to work with them, I'll I'll be a blessing.
Yeah, definitely, man. You know what I'm saying? So they're already digging your stuff, man. So you on your way, brother. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Hopefully you can produce their kids. That'd be tight, huh? It'd be a bone thing for real, you know? Definitely, man. So, okay. So this is DJ U-Neek Middleton. You know what I'm saying? This is his birth name. D-E capital J-A-E. Yeah, man. So he the one that handles the filming, and he does photography, a little skateboarding on the side, works Pro Tools, do a little engineering. He do it all, you know what I'm saying? So I just wanted to, you know, catch up with you, man, and get your thoughts and some of your, you know, memories of hanging out with Bone.
Yeah.
Definitely. All right, man.
Oh, man, damn, y'all back again. I just told y'all I was BoneThugsDJUneek.com.
Yo, we here with my man DJ CS4 Bam at Bomb Ass Music here in South Central Los Angeles. Yo, what's going on, my man?
What's up, you nigga? How we doing today, man?
Doing good, man. Yeah, we just wanted to catch up with you, man, because we got this new Bone album called The Art of War, World War III, man, and we just want to see what you feel about it, because you was around during the recording. So, can you give us some of your insight on it, brother?
Man, well, I'm going to tell you, it's one of the hottest, most recent albums that I've heard. You know, and I go through a lot of albums or through a lot of songs, you know, just DJing and here at the shop playing music all day from different type of artists, man. I think it's up there with some of the hottest stuff that Bone has ever made. One of my favorites, it's a Bone Thing. That's one of the ones that I like the most, man. But, I'm really enjoying it, man.
What you like about that that particular song?
That song, it takes me, I don't know, it gives me like this whole feeling of some classic Bone. The female singing on there is just doing it for me, and the fella's Bone is just putting it down, man. So I really, really, really like that song, man. It sticks out for me a lot.
Yeah, man. And that's what we was trying to do, capture the classic sound, you know what I'm saying, and bring it back, man. You know what I'm saying? What are some of your favorite Bone cuts, though, man, from back in the day?
Back in the day, but I still, you know, first of the month, really, you know what I mean? Ecstasy, you know, I have some favorite ones. It's All Good, that are probably not exactly, you know, just Bone, but they part of the Bone family, you know. Ghetto Cowboy is a dope one, you know. It's one of the ones that kind of like, it's different, but I like it, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
Bone, you know what I mean? But they got so many songs, man. The one with Tupac, Thug Love, the one with Notorious B.I.G.
You
know, Bone is just doing it, man.
Yeah, definitely, man. So yeah, man, and all, you know, actually, you and DJ here, man, was off in the studio, and you guys had laid some tracks down for the album, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So we got to see, you know what I'm saying, what makes the cut, you know? You know what I'm
exactly,
saying? Because CS4 Bam does the tracks, he DJs, part of the Cali Kings, a big DJ pool organization out here, got his own record shop, got his own clothing line, you know what I'm saying? And there it is right there, you can zoom in right there, got his own clothes.
Man, t-shirt, I'm the bomb.
I'm the bomb.
You the bomb.
Yeah, man.
Are you Bone fans?
Yeah, man. So he's doing it all. Production, everything. So look out for DJ CS4 Bam and Bankroll Music. You know what I'm saying? It's the next movement that's taking over. 2013.
It's your boy Tim representing A18. That's right. Fresh Avenue, baby. What's going on?
What's your most memorable moment with Bone?
When I first met him when I was 5 years old. Yep. Rushed to the studio, met him off that studio on Sunset. Yeah, man, I was excited to meet him, man. Met all five of them, you know what I mean? And it's been cool ever since.
For sure.
My dad was taking Bone to a show. I think it was Club Nokia in Hollywood. I was talking to Crazy Bone about some music and stuff. And he was acting like pretty crazy and stuff. And I also remember in the studio with Bone before, with Busy. I talked to him. He was being funny in the studio, like always.
Yo, what y'all doing here? What's going on? This is DJ U-Neek, Bone Thugs and Harmony, Bone Thugs, DJUneek.com. What's happening? See me, got my NWA shirt on, you know. It's March 2013. This is the 18th year anniversary to my man Eazy-E's death. Rest in peace, you know. I got a couple things I'm working on. I'm doing a In Memory of Eazy-E mixtape. I'm gonna put that on Dat Piff live mixtape. And I'm gonna have it on my site for sure for y'all to, you know, definitely download. But y'all gotta definitely check out my site. And that's Bone Thugs DJ U-Neek. There's a lot going on. Bone is been on the road, you know, said all five members hitting the road real hard. I got Bankroll Music, Block to Block, Hood to Hood, Hollywood Square, Genetic Genius, Brucey B. You know what I'm saying? Then we got the Art of War, World War III going down. It really, this is a bone year, you know what I'm saying? But right now, with me having this on, you know what I'm saying? This is really in memory of my man Eazy-E, you know what I'm saying? Who put us down. And, you know, I'm definitely, you know what I'm saying, going to drop this mixtape, you know what I'm saying? It's called In Memory of Eazy-E, that's what I'm pumping up. And also, I've been hitting y'all with the making of East 1999 Eternal, and I know y'all been loving that, you know what I'm saying? So I'm gonna keep on hitting y'all with that, and that's exclusive for BoneThugsDJUnique.com. So definitely, you know what I'm saying? Keep hitting the website, you know what I'm saying? Keep, you know what I'm saying, coming to the shows, and we definitely finna start hitting y'all with music. Also, I got the quick fix that I mixed for my man Crazy Bone. We got Leatherface Part 2, and we got Chasing the Devil coming, you know what I'm saying? That's definitely coming. I know y'all been waiting, but it's worth the wait, you know what I'm saying? So yo, this is DJ Unique of Bone Thugs and Harmony at BoneThugsDJUnique.com is where it's at, you know what I'm saying? Yo, 2013, baby, Bone.